हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग ग्रेट। आई एम आंचल चौधरी, वर्किंग एज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन मैनेजमेंट डिपार्टमेंट। आई एम बैक विद माय ऑनलाइन लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ इनकम टैक्स। एंड एज यू नो, आई एम कवरिंग दिस सिलेबस ऑफ बीबीए एंड बीकॉम ऑफ ऑल यूनिवर्सिटीज। सो दिस इज माय सेकंड वीडियो फ्रॉम द बेसिक्स ऑफ इनकम टैक्स। एंड इफ यू हैवंट सीन माय प्रीवियस वीडियो, देन दिस वीडियो विल नॉट हेल्प यू सो मच। So I request you to watch my previous lecture of income tax for your better understanding. I have provided the link in the description given below to help you to understand the basics of income tax. So let's start with today's lecture. So students, it's your lecture number 2 from introduction of income tax. In previous lecture, we have studied your definition of tax. What is taxation? Why are tax levied? Who is assessee? Person, assessment year, and your residential status, which is covered under income tax. And last, we have covered the heads of income. And today, we are going to start with the computation of total income. So, what all steps are included in your computation of total income? What are the certain cases when income of a previous year will be assessed in the previous year itself? What are the tax slab rates of the individual, HUF, company? All are included under the tax slab rates. So what is the exact tax slab rates for each situation? And your residential status and scope of total income. And last, we will cover the exempted income, which is covered under the income tax. So let's start with today's lecture. So these are the steps, you can say, to compute the total income. So this is how you have to compute your total income. First of all, you have to determine the residential status of a person. Then you have to classify the income of that person under the different heads. That is your salaries, income from house properties, profits and gains from business or profession, capital gains, income from other sources. So you have to classify all your income under these 5 heads. Then after dividing the income, then you have to compute income under each head, applying the charging and deeming provisions and providing for permissible deductions and exemptions thereunder. So whatever the permissible deductions and exemptions are available under different heads, you have to compute those deductions and you have to compute income after those deductions. Then after that, you have to apply the clubbing provisions. If there is any clubbing of income is there, so you have to club the income of that person into the assessee's income. Then after that, you have to write off any set off or carry forward of losses. So this is the next step where you have to set off the losses which is which has been occurred in your previous year. So you have to set off right now. If it's not possible to set off the entire amount, or if you are not able to set off that particular amount of loss, then you have to carry forward that income, that loss to the next year. Then after that, whatever the amount you will get the gross total income. So that is your gross total income. And after deducting various deductions from GTI or gross total income, whatever the amount you will get, that will be your total income. Then on that total income, you will levy the tax rates. So this is how you have to compute the tax rates. You have to compute your total income under the Income Tax Act. Students, generally, whenever we compute the income tax on the assessee's income, so we compute it on the basis of previous year's income. So whenever we apply the tax on the income, so we compute that tax on the previous year of that particular person. But there are certain circumstances, there are certain cases in which you have to exempt this rule. Whenever you feel that you are required to compute the tax on the current year income only, so there are some certain cases also, and these are permissible under the Income Tax Act. So let's discuss these cases. Certain cases when income of a previous year will be assessed in the previous year itself. Whenever you are computing the tax of the previous year's income and you are taxing that value, taxing that income in previous year only. So general rule says that income of the previous year is assessed in the assessment year following the previous year, right? So it's your general rule. Whenever you are taxing the amount of income of previous year, but you are taxing that amount in your assessment year. But there is an exception to this rule, which is in the following circumstances. These are the following cases in which this rule is exempted. First, shipping business of non-resident, persons leaving India, AOP, BOI, artificial judicial person formed for a particular event or purpose, persons likely to transfer property to avoid tax, discontinued business. So basically, whenever you feel that shipping business whenever a shipping business is performed by a non-resident person, so there are, you can say there are chances that that person will not come back to India. So whatever the amount you feel that particular amount of tax will be levied on that shipping business, so you have to levy on that particular year only. So where a ship belongs to a charter by a non-resident carries passenger, mail or goods shipped at a port in India. The ship is allowed to leave the port only when the tax has been paid or satisfactory arrangements has been made for the payment thereof. So whenever you feel that kisi bhi non-resident person hai and that is shipping some goods to India. So on that purpose, what you have to do is you have to levy the tax on those income, on those goods which is brought up by the non-resident. So that because see, things are not certain ki aap us person ko dubara contact karoge or ya fir aap baad mein cheeze karoge. See, if a person, agar koi person non-resident hai, wo residential hi nahi hai India ka, then in that case there is a risk involved in that. So what you have to do is ki jab bhi wo aapke sath business kar rahe hain, whenever they are वो अपना गुड्स लेकर आ रहे हैं इंडिया में, वेन एवर दे आर ब्रिंगिंग दैट गुड्स इन इंडिया, सो इमीडिएटली आपको टैक्स लिवाई कर देना चाहिए, बिकॉज दैट पर्सन दैट गुड्स बिलोंग्स टू अ नॉन रेजिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया. नेक्स्ट इज पर्सन्स लीविंग इंडिया. वेन एवर यू फील दैट अ पर्सन इज लीविंग इंडिया एंड ही इज नॉट हैविंग सर्टेन you can say plan to come back to India in next year or maybe next to next year. So what you have to do is you have to immediately impose the tax on that person's income in your current year only. Next is AOP, BOI, when it is formed for a particular event or purpose. When these kind of associations are formed for a particular event, then at the time of dissolution of that AOP or BOI, you have to impose the tax thereon. Next is persons likely to transfer property to avoid tax. Many times it has been considered that many of the person feels that if they sell out that property, particular property in the current year itself to avoid the tax, so उस सिचुएशन को बचने के लिए, उससे बचने के लिए what government has planned कि government is very smart enough, government आपको बिना tax pay किए तो नहीं जाने देगी. So इसीलिए ये rule बनाया है कि अगर कोई person अपनी property को transfer कर रहा है in your current year to avoid tax, but वो बचेगा नहीं, he has to pay the tax only in the current year only, so then also that person has to pay the tax, वो बच नहीं सकता. next is your discontinued business. Whenever you are closing some business of yours, you are discontinuing your business. In that situation also, whenever you are disclosing that you are discontinuing this business, on the same per day you have to also pay the tax liability, which is computed on that particular basis. So let us discuss the slab rates of taxation, which is based on the assessment year 2020 and 21. So these are the latest tax rates which are applied in India. First is individual, HUF, AOP, BOI and artificial judicial person. Whenever your income tax is levied on these person, then in that case your tax rates will be up to 2,50,000. You will not pay any amount of tax, right? And for whenever your income is exceeding 2,50,000, but it is up to 5 lakh only, then in that case you will levy the tax rate at the 5%. But students, just remember that whatever the amount is concluded up to like 2,50,000, that will be your nil. Us par aap koi amount in tax ka nahi pay karoge. So whenever you are earning some income, like for say your income is rupees 3 lakh, so you have to pay the 5% tax on your 50,000 only, because 2,50,000 pe to aapka nil hai amount. So isi tarike se aap table banana whenever you are solving a question. So you have to prepare a table to solve that, to compute the taxation amount. That will be helpful for you. For whenever a total income is exceeding 5 lakh, but it is included like it is up to 10 lakh rupees only, then in that case you have to pay the 20% tax. So in this situation, suppose a person is having 6 lakh income, right? So up to 2,50,000, that person's tax will be nil, and on 2,50,000, that amount of taxation will be 5%, and the remaining 1 lakh, on 1 lakh he have to pay the 20% of tax. And in last situation, whenever your total income is exceeding 10 lakh, in that situation you have to pay a tax of 30%. So this is how you have to calculate the taxation rates of your individual, HUF, AOP, BOI and AJP. In next situation, whenever an individual is aged above than 60 years, but his age is less than 80 years, then the tax slab rate will be different for that person, and that person is known as senior citizen. So for that senior citizen, up to 3 lakh income, your amount of taxation will be nil. Whenever your total income is exceeding 3 lakh, but it is up to 5 lakh only, then in that situation, your tax rate will be 5%. Whenever your total income is exceeding 5 lakh, but it is under the 10 lakh rupees, then you have to pay the 20% of tax. When your total income is exceeding 10 lakh rupees, then you have to pay the tax of 30%. So there is a third situation also. When a person's age is 80 years, when a person is more than 80 years, then in that situation, your tax slab will be, your income will be exempted up to 5 lakh. So here, up to 5 lakh you don't have to pay any amount of tax, and between 5 lakh and 10 lakh income you have to pay a tax of 20%. When your total income is exceeding 10 lakh, in that situation you have to pay the tax of 30%. So this is how you have to calculate the tax rates of individual, taxable income of individuals. In case of a firm or LLP, on their total income, the tax will be levied at 30%. When it's a local authority, then on the total income of local authority, the tax rate will be 30%. When you have a earning from the cooperative society, when you have to calculate the income of cooperative society and taxable income, then in that case, where the total income does not exceed 10,000, then tax rate will be 10% of the total income. When total income is between rupees 10,000 and 20,000, then the tax rate will be 20%. And when the total income of cooperative society exceeds 20,000 rupees, then in that case, the percentage of tax will be 30%. So this is how you have to calculate your tax rates under different heads. In case of a company, the tax rates will be as follows. When the company is a domestic company, then if the total turnover or gross receipt of a company is equals to or less than rupees 400 crore, then the tax rate will be 25% of total income. And when the amount of total turnover and gross receipt is more than 400 crore, then in that case, the tax rate will be 30% of total income. In case of a company other than a domestic company, if it's not a domestic company, then in that case, 40% of the total income will be levied as a tax on that particular income. Residential status and scope of total income. So now we will have a look whether these income will be taxable under different residential status or not. First is income received or deemed to be received in India during the previous year. So whenever that particular income is received or it will be received in future, but it is in India only. You are receiving that income in India. Then in that case, resident and ordinary resident have to pay tax on that particular income. If that person is resident but not ordinary resident, then also you have to pay tax. And in case of non-resident also, you have to pay the tax on certain income. When income accruing or arising or deemed to accrue or arise in India during the previous year. If income is accrued or arising from India only, then in all of these three situations, that income will be taxable. It will be taxable under resident but not ordinary resident, and non-resident. And last situation is income accruing or arising outside India. Whenever the income is accruing and arising outside India, in that case, resident and ordinary resident has to pay the tax on that certain income, even if such income is not received or brought into India. Then also that tax will be levied on that income. In case of resident but not ordinary resident, so the income will be taxable, but only if such income is derived from a business controlled in a profession set up in India. Otherwise, no taxation will be paid on. And in case of non-resident, the person who is receiving the income of that kind of income, so non-resident do not have to pay any tax on certain income. Last topic of the day is exempted income. So this chart will help you to understand the exempted income. These are the all kind of income which are exempted under Income Tax Act. So exempted income can be divided into two parts. First is your fully exempted, and next is partially exempted, where certain amount of exemptions are available and in partially you have to pay the income tax also. So in fully exempted income, it includes agricultural income, amount received by a member from the income of the HUF, interest on NRE account, share income of a partner, exemption in respect of remuneration to individuals, royalty or fees for technical services, compensation received on account of disaster, allowances payable outside India by the government to a citizen of India, payment from Sukanya Samriddhi account, payment to Bhopal gas victims, education scholarships, awards by the government, income tax paid by the employer whenever an employer is paying the income tax on your behalf, pension received by receipt of gallantry awards, payment from PF or superannuation fund, tea board subsidy and other subsidies, certain payments to MPs and MLAs, capital gain on transfer of a unit or unit scheme, income from units from administrator of specified undertaking, family pension received by a widow, children or nominator heirs of a armed force members, capital gain on compulsory acquisition of agricultural land, income received on buyback of shares of domestic company, income received in transaction of reverse mortgage. And in case of partially exempted income, these are the income: gratuity, leave travel concession, encashment of utilized earned leave on retirement, commutation of pension, voluntary retirement receipts, retrenchment compensation, receipts from LIC, house rent allowances, special allowance or benefit, payment from NPS trust to an SSC, payment from NPS trust to an employee, income of member of a scheduled tribe, interest income arising to certain person, exemptions in respect of clubbed income, exemption of a specific income of Sikkimese individual, specified allowance and prerequisite paid to chairman or a retired chairman, and last is your dividend referred to in section 115. So these are the all kind of exemptions which can be covered in your throughout the Income Tax Act. So apart from these income, there is no any kind of exemptions which are allowed or which is covered under the Income Tax Act. So we have covered, we have discussed all of these exemptions. So students, that's it for today's lecture. In next video, we will cover the remaining theory portion and we will also start solving some numerical portion so that your concepts will be more clear and your theory will be understood by the help of numericals. So here are the questions based on today's lecture. Question number 1. What all exemptions are available under Income Tax Act? Discuss in detail. So you have to solve this question, and in case you have any kind of doubt, you are facing any kind of difficulty in this subject, so you can contact me. You can let me know about your difficulties, about your doubts, so that I can clear them, and I will also try to arrange a live session for you to understand your difficulties and to clear them all. Students, if you like today's lecture, then please like, share and subscribe to my channel for my motivation. Thank you so much for your time. Stay tuned for more videos.